I have lessons to come to the front if you don't mind. Is that all right? I want you to come and sit right here. Take these three rows, amen. Don't be afraid. I gotta get people not to be afraid of this front seat. For some reason, this seat has some, I don't know what it is, but no one wants to sit there. So let me just go ahead and test it out. It's all right. Okay. All right. There you go. It's all right. Thank you all. While they are coming, I want to just ask Deacon Hutchison if he would stand. Deacon Hutchison, amen. Deacon Hutchison is being recognized as a high achiever at the same United Save Ourselves. He is being recognized, and we want to always identify Christian men where they are being elevated for recognition. Deacon Hutchison, Deacon Coleman, stand. Deacon Coleman, Deacon Coleman. He is being recognized. As a matter of fact, he is the first African American to be seated as secretary for a national organization. Is the agency? The National Guardianship Association. He's the first African American to be seated as secretary. And that is not just the only position I see. It's one of the greater things that's going to happen for him. So we just thank God for him. And we want to recognize. And then there's, where's Brother Edwards? Brother Edwards, he's a deacon, and he has coached an undefeated team. Amen. They were undefeated. Also, he coached a team that made it to the second rounds of the playoffs. And so we're very grateful and very thankful for these men who are being used by God. One of the things that I've said to them is that if you can't sing, we want you in the male chorus. Let me just go ahead and say that. If you can't sing, if you cannot sing, we want you in the male chorus. Now, if you can sing, that's a great thing. But what I want you to know that being in the male chorus, we're shifting the paradigm. We want to start a movement where we have 50 or more men who are not ashamed of standing before you on a Sunday morning and allowing God to use them. That's what the male chorus is going to be about. It's getting a group of men together for the cause of Christ, whether you can sing or not. So do not let singing be a hindrance or a barrier for you coming. Amen? So we want to ask that you will see Brother Campbell, or if they practice on what, the second Thursday? The men choirs practice on what, the second Thursday? The first and second Thursday at 6 o'clock. So we want you to come. If you can't sing, you meet the criteria. Amen. Amen. So don't say, well, I can't sing. They'll teach you how to sing. Amen. Amen. I want to thank you. Let's give these young people a hand. I want to thank you, parents, first of all, for continuing to think enough to encourage and to bring your children, your teenagers, to the Lord's house. You're planting seeds by your presence that allows them to know what you value and allow them to get a clear picture of how important the church is. Now, I want you to get a clear picture that God elevates and uses within his family, in his body. He uses people who are available to allow him to be glorified. So he will elevate them. He will help them to be recognized. He will help them to achieve. And so I said to these that we recognize today, I understand the humility, and people say, well, I don't want people to know that I got this or that. But that's still in the glory from God. Because he says, I didn't allow this to happen for you to keep it to yourself. Not to be conceited or arrogant, but when you come to understand who allowed you to get to where you are, you give him glory. And you make it very clear, the reason that I've achieved what I've achieved is because of him. And he's faithful to the faithful. Now we recognize Deacon Coleman, we recognize Deacon Hutchison, we recognize Deacon Marcus Edwards and others, but I want to ask Miss Gloria that if she was stand. This Gloria battle was a part of the civil rights movement right there in Montgomery, Alabama. She knew this world's a past. See, we have people in our midst that God has used to be an example for us. Since the battle will be recognized on February the 5th in Montgomery at Alabama State University for the Marion Award. And so we want to congratulate her. Now, Sister Battle is a Sunday school teacher. Now she can say, well, I don't have time, or either I'm too good to. No, every Sunday, she's a Sunday school teacher for one of our largest classes, the women's class. But she's also our church librarian, because she was a librarian by profession in the Muskogee County school system and some other systems. Amen. Amen. So we want to thank God for him using you, Ms. Battle, and Deacon Hutchison. He's a deacon. He's a servant. Because we don't have positions, we have servants. Deacon Coleman, servant. Deacon Marcus Edwards, servant. And there are others. So I'm saying to you, 4th Street, when God allows you to be recognized, let us know. When your children are recognized, let us know. Because if we don't accentuate, if we don't lift them up, we will always think our children are the worst thing that can ever happen, and they are not. And I want our young people here today to know that you have greatness in you. God wants to use you so that he will get glory. But I want to just take some time to just read a passage of scripture so that you will know what is happening in this day and time. It has been prophesied, it has been talked about, and I want to make sure that you don't get entangled with what is happening in this time. And that's why I want you to come and to study the word. I don't just want you to just say, well, I got a Bible, but never read it. I don't want you to just know scripture. I want you to know what scripture means. And so we want to introduce this passage to you. Some of you may know it. I want you to take your Bible. If you have a cell phone, iPad, you can use your cell phone, iPad. Ask the media ministry, is it okay for me to move? Can I move? No, okay. They told me I can't move. We are streaming live, so I want to make sure. That's my boundary. So here and here, I can't go down there. So I can't go in the front. So you got, okay. Our production manager is producing. Okay, gotcha. All right. Amen. Amen. I want to ask Brother Allison. I want you to read from 2 Timothy. Take this one, that one right there. And I'm going to read from the Contemporary English Version. And I want you to read from verses, chapter number 3. To verse number 9, 1-9. So you can take that. We're going to have a fireside chat. Is that all right, church? Yeah. All right. Reverend Allison is going to read 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1-9. Is that all right? So parents, we want you to go. If you've got your iPad, then take your iPad. Got your cell phone, take your cell phone. Just don't be playing, what's that, sweetheart, what's that name again? Russell. Don't play Russell. She didn't think I was going to remember. Don't play Russell or Candy Crush. What are some of the games y'all play on y'all iPhones? What's that? What? Minecraft. Okay. Don't do that then. All right. If you use an iPhone. All right. All right, we're going to go to the Word. Is that all right? Everybody got your Bible? If you need a Bible, there's a Bible in the back of the pew, so please feel free to turn to 2 Timothy chapter number 3, verses 1-9. Let's listen to what people will be like in the last days. This Paul is describing as he writes to his son in the ministry, Timothy, and he's describing what people will look like in the last days. And I want you young people to tell me if this resembles what we are living in and what you're living in terms of your culture today, okay? All right, let's go.
2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. But understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty, for the people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unpeaceable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with contempt, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness but denying its power. Avoid such people, for among them are those who creep into the households and capture weak women, burdened with sins and led astray by various passions, always learning and never able to arrive at a knowledge of the truth. Just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, so these men also oppose the truth, men corrupted in mind and disqualified regarding the faith. But they will not get very far, for their folly will be plain to all, and as with that of those two men. Amen.
All right, thank you. That's from the English Standard Version. This is what I want to ask. We're going to read the Contemporary English Version now, okay? The Contemporary English Version. I'm going to come down here. You all okay? All right. This is what it says in the Contemporary English Version. I want you to listen to it. It says, same chapter, 2 Timothy, chapter number 3, verses 1 through 9. Listen up. You can be certain that in the last days, there will be some very hard times. People will love only themselves and money. They will be proud, stuck up, rude, and disobedient to their parents. They will also be ungrateful, godless, heartless, and hateful. Their words will be cruel, and they will have no self-control or pity. These people will hate everything that is good. They will be sneaky, reckless, and puffed up with pride. Instead of loving God, they will love pleasure. Even though they will make a show of being religious, their religion won't be real. Don't have anything to do with such people. Let me just go ahead and ask y'all to repeat that with me. Don't. Y'all got to get with it. Y'all, I call that a football game. Right? We have any cheerleaders in here? All right, I want a cheerleader. Can I get a cheerleader to come up here? Who's our cheerleader? Come on, y'all want all cheerleaders to come up here. I want you to lead this cheer. All right? Amen. Who are your cheerleader for?
Baker Middle School.
Baker Middle School. Come on, let's give it up for Baker Middle School cheerleader. Amen. Who are your cheerleader for? Harbor High School Tigers. Come on. Let me just, come on, let's get together. Let's develop this cheer, okay? Here's the cheer. Here it is. Here it is. Don't. All right, like that? All right, I got to do it. Don't have Robert's cheer at Baker Middle School in Colorado. On the count of three. One, two, three. Here we go. I'm gonna help you. On the count of three. One, two, three. Don't have anything to do with such people. All right? All right, don't go nowhere yet. Now I'll be back. All right, because now y'all gotta follow up now when we follow, all right? Y'all wanna help us? One, two, three. Don't have anything to do with such people. Y'all gonna do it again? I saw somebody that said nothing yet. Y'all not enthusiastic. Okay, on the count of three. One, two, three. Don't have anything to do with such people. Come on, let's give it up. Come on, say yeah! Our producer, he said, Red Flakes, the only thing I can get is the top of your head. All right, there. I go. That's my point. Thank you, Sir Michael. Amen. All right. So here's what it says. Don't have anything to do with such people. You all see that? Then it says, some men fool whole families just to get power over these women who are slaves of sin and are controlled by all sorts of desires. These women always want to learn something new, but they never can discover the truth. Just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, these people are enemies of the truth. Their minds are sick. Their faith isn't real, but they won't get very far with their foolishness. Soon, everyone will know the truth about them, but as Jannes and Jambres were found out. Don't have anything to do with such people. Here's the question, as you heard that, I want you to ask yourself, who does this remind me of? Do I have these types of characteristics? Do I demonstrate a rudeness to my mother, my father? Do I have a rudeness to my teachers? I just want to ask us, and not only that, our children, our teenagers, but adults, we need to examine what we may be passing on to our children. The Bible is clear. In the last days, these are the kinds of people we will run into in our community, in our home, in school, young people. Do you know of anybody that's rude, that's in your classroom? Do you know of anybody that's rude in your community? Maybe on the cheerleading team. Maybe in the band. Maybe on the football, basketball team. Maybe in the glee club or the choir. Do you know that that's not of God? To be rude to anyone. And so if you say that you're a child of God, if you say that you've given Christ your life, it does not matter. It does not matter what people do to you. What matters is how you respond to them. Why don't you all say that with me? It does not matter how people treat me. But what matters is how I treat them. You're not responsible for how they respond to you, but you are responsible for how you respond to them. Those are some principles that you need to be very clear about as young people. Because as you go in and out of the classroom, as you go in and out of college, or as you go in and out of elementary school, or you go in and out of middle school, you need to understand that it is a sin to be rude. Are you all following me? Are you tracking me? And if someone doesn't tell you, then you will go on, not you, but in general, there are teenagers, there are adolescents, there are little children who believe that it's okay to roll their eyes at their mom and dad. Thinks it's okay to talk back to their mother or father or their grandmother. And I'm saying the Bible says in the last days we will see children like this. We will see adults like this. But that's not what you want to pick up on. Because you have come to realize that it's not of God. Is it of God? Is it wrong? And you need to know very early what's right and what's wrong, so that you don't get caught up in some lifestyles or some attitudes that will end up destroying your entire life. All right? So listen to what it says. So is it okay to be rude? Right? So it's not okay to be rude. Right? Can we all agree upon that? So when you find, if you have a best friend that's rude to their mother or father, what does the Bible teach? Don't have anything to do with such people. That means that you don't have to treat them mean. It just means if you find a friend or a so-called friend that they disrespect or they're rude to their mother and father, you don't want them. Now, parents, grandparents, adults, I need to have some support from somewhere. Because, see, if I'm just saying this and they're hearing me say it and we don't hear you agreeing with it, they're just going to say, well, that's just what the pastor's saying. But do the parents agree with that? Let me just ask you this. Do you all agree with what the Word of God says? The Word of God says don't have anything to do with such people. Let me just go ahead and say this, because some of the parents need to understand, if you have friends that's being rude to their husband or their wife or being rude to you, first of all, you need to make sure that they understand that is not going to be accepted. We have to change how we treat one another. Because these little ones are watching whom? They're watching us. And if we don't care about one another, then what are they learning? Not to care about each other. We cannot raise a generation that don't care about each other. We have some people. We have some children. We have some young people who, if you step on their shoe, they're going to look at you as if you just have committed the worst crime in the world. As opposed to saying that person didn't mean to do that, give the person the benefit of the doubt. We have people that don't give each other the benefit of the doubt with nothing. Don't do that no more. You got, you know, if you do, there are some people now, you know, if you do something that someone, that offends someone, you don't know what they're going to do. Are you all following me? The church has to transform our society. We have to turn our society around, because our society is looking, is the society looking like this today? You can go to a restaurant. You can go to the mall. And you just wonder, do they teach customer service? Are you all following me? I'm not trying to rain on McDonald's parade, but you know, you can drive through the drive-thru. And you just ask, have this person been through customer service? What you want? It's as if you're bothering that person. Hurry up. We are in a rude society. The other thing that you have to understand, when an adult is talking, you don't talk. Are y'all following me? Are y'all following me? you say, if you're stepping up and your mother, your father is having a conversation with an adult, the first thing you want to say is what? Excuse me. There are some people that I've seen say, my child won't have to say excuse me. It's, well, I'm just saying excuse me. We have to be careful what we're teaching our kids. Do you know you have parents who say that their children don't have to say thank you? The Bible says give thanks in everything. And they need to learn that if someone does something kind and nice to them, for them, they need to learn to be grateful. And say thank you. Are you all following me? Everybody say thank you. All right? You want to make sure that you don't have an attitude of ungratefulness. All right? Then it says this. It says, people will love only themselves and money. We have to be careful that we do not teach our children the only thing that's valued in life is money. Now, let me just say this. I want y'all to know this. Money is great. Just don't become so in love with it that you'll do anything for it. Now, let me just say this. Since you may not be old enough to have a job yet, you have a job. You do. You pay tithe. No. If mama says you start tomorrow, amen. That's what I'm talking about. Amen. Amen. So what I'm saying is, if you don't have a job and you say, well, Pastor, this doesn't relate to me. But let me just say this. Don't love material things so much that it will cause you to do something to get it. Don't love, and we just had, is it Son John in yesterday? Damon John, the owner of FUBU, that the brand master in terms of creating companies and brands that have made millions and millions of dollars. He was in Columbus yesterday. But let me just say this to you. Don't love brands so much that it'll cause you to go out and steal to get it. Y'all following me? If it doesn't belong to you, then go and ask your mother or your father, your grandmother or your grandfather, or your aunt or your uncle, who does this belong to if you found it, because it doesn't belong to you. Don't love it so much that it'll cause you to want to sneak and get it. It says there are going to be people who are sneaky. Don't go into the mall, and I just want to help y'all with this, and believe that you can take something, put it up under your coat, and nobody looking. The whole mall can be empty, but there is a big audience. They've got plenty looking. And are you all, need to understand there are cameras in places. You can go into the dressing room thinking that nobody's in there with you. You can put on another pair of pants over another pair of pants, a sweater over another sweater, and come out. I'm just telling you, there's a camera there that's going to record you stealing. And to come out and say, well, I didn't mean to. Come on, let's be real. Can we talk? The Bible teaches that stealing is wrong. Don't love material things to the point it'll cause you to covet it. That means to desire it so much that you'll do anything for it. Let me just say this. Don't let anyone make you go out and sell anything for money. He says, don't be lovers of money. Money is not the root of evil, it's the love of it. The love of materials, sneakers. Anybody have a sneaker fetish? Y'all know what a sneaker fetish is? That means you just have to have sneakers. I mean, you love sneakers. Anybody? So, okay, all right. you know, you got collections of sneakers, you know. Well, don't love sneakers to the point that it'll cause you to do something or anything to get them. Y'all hear me? They're not that important. They're only material. Matter of fact, you know what? They're charging $150. They only probably cost $25 or $15. Are you following me? And they just got a brand on it, whether it's Allen Iverson, whether it's Michael Jordan, or whether it's now, you know, Seth, what's his name? Curry, he's the man, isn't he? You know, LeBron James still got it going on. They got their brand. But let me just tell you this. They're making millions off the brands that you are paying them. Are you hearing what I'm saying? But don't do anything to try and get a Seth Curry's jersey or tennis shoes or Michael Jordan. They're not that important that it will destroy your life. It will end up getting something on your record that won't come off, and it will prohibit you from going to the school that you want to go to, or maybe stay on your record long enough that you may not even be able to get a job. He says, don't be selfish. Only love yourself. And we are living in a society where people only think of themselves. Or either their immediate circle. When you're in the body of Christ, he wants you to think more of others than you do of yourself. Are you all following me? Parents, let me just say something. Take this passage. Sit down intentionally and purposefully and teach them to your children, your child. Read over it once a week. Read over it. Whatever time you designate, your children need to know this. Okay? Your children need to know this. Then it says, don't be stuck up. Anybody tell me what stuck up means here? What does stuck up mean?
Don't be like staying with that thing that you have that like you said, don't stay with the things that you that may cause you to get in trouble again.
Okay, you're listening, but what does stuck up mean? Anybody know what stuck up mean?
Having too much pride.
Thinking you're better than somebody else. Standoffish. Have you seen people who are standoffish? And their children look at them. I don't want to be a part of them people. You know, we live over here and they live over there. We go to this certain school and they go to that certain school. I don't want to hang out with people who go to that school. They can only come to my party. Here's what you learn as young people. It doesn't matter what school you go to. Doesn't matter what kind of clothes you wear. At the end of the day, you need to believe that you're all the same. God created you. And you don't want to get involved into cliques. Right, parents? The certain kind of schools. You know, I joke a lot about Tuskegee and Alabama State and Georgia and Alabama and, you know, the very different schools. I do it in a way to be jovial, to have fun. But do you know whether you went to Tuskegee, Alabama State, Georgia, Alabama, Harvard, Yale, whatever the case might have been, when it really comes down to the Lord's house, it makes absolutely no difference. Let me put it this way. It shouldn't make any difference. We're celebrating Dr. King's birthday tomorrow. Dr. King would have been approximately, maybe he would have been over 80 years old if he had lived to celebrate his birthday tomorrow. Do you know what many historians believe about Dr. King if he had lived? They believe that Dr. King would have been a pariah to the society in which he lived. A pariah. He would have been an adjutant. He would have been an antagonist. He would have been so annoying to a society because Dr. King was all about making sure the least, the less, and the lost had a voice. Dr. King was a Nobel Peace Prize winner. He was a Boston graduate. He graduated from Morehouse School, Morehouse College. He was a scholar. He was an intellect. But Dr. King would also stand and say, I'm a black Baptist preacher. He could sit with paupers. He could sit with garbage workers and make them feel comfortable. And he could sit with the President of the United States of America and still be just as comfortable. What you need to develop is this. You need to develop such a humility and such an attitude that you don't make people feel as if they don't belong in your company. Doesn't matter what high school you go to. Doesn't matter what college, doesn't matter how much money you have or you don't have. We need to treat each other with kindness. The whole message of Dr. King was about love. Not lovers of self, but he thought more of others than he did of himself. Do you not know what got Dr. King killed? He went to Memphis, Tennessee to really to march on behalf of garbage workers because they did not have appropriate living wages. They were not making enough money to provide for their families. And Dr. King was saying, this is unfair. This is unjust. And what I would like for our young people here, we have a ministry where they can come. And there are a couple of young men who come. I'm going to ask them to stand. I know Devin. Devin, stand, if you don't mind, please. If you've served in the Recovery Through Christ ministry, you've come. This is a ministry where alcoholics and drug addicts who are trying to get their life back on track, some are homeless, some are not, they come every Saturday at 9, and there's a ministry that cooks breakfast for them, and we don't have them to come and pick up the breakfast. We have youth and others who will take the breakfast and go serve them. He's a part of it. He's been doing it for almost 3 or some years. Are there any other youth who served in that ministry? Have they actually volunteered? Well, this is what I want you to do. I want every youth to take at least 1 month that you would come and you would participate in that ministry. Learn how to serve and not be served. Because there, come on, let's give it up for Devin. Come on, let's give it up. And parents, what I'm asking you to support is that we want our young people to not love themselves so much that they will feel that they're entitled to things. We have a society where young people are growing up, not these, but young people are growing up and they feel that they're entitled. I'm supposed to have this. I'm supposed to have that. And because I deserve it, when you don't give it to me, I don't have it, then guess what? We have some young people not only will become rude, but they will even go out and get it because they feel that they deserve it. Is there anybody here? And we want our young people, when they come to the Lord's house, we want them to know that is not godly. And you want to remove yourself from such people. Is that right? Then it says, y'all have any questions so far? Does this make sense? And is this helping you all? Because there are some people who love themselves, they're standoffish, they won't embrace anybody, and when they go out, they will keep thinking that that's right, and it's not. We are a family. We are the body of Christ. And if you have not given your life to Christ, then Christ desires that you be saved and you become a part of his family. But if we don't disciple you, if we don't teach them family, then they'll grow up. They'll say, well, I'm a member of the church. But they don't know who Jesus is. They don't know what Jesus has done. They don't know how to get to heaven. They don't know that they've been set aside, that God wants to use them to bring others to Christ. The only thing they know, I'm a member of a church. And they'll be 40 years in and not know the basic things about Christ. And isn't that a travesty? That people will say, I'm saved, but they will not even know to tell you what that means. We don't want our children to grow up saying, I'm saved, and they don't have a clue about what that means. Being saved means that God has changed your life. Come on, I said we need some help here. That may have helped somebody up in here. Being saved means it's not just walking down the aisle saying, I want to give Christ my life. Yes, I answer all these questions. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Lord. I believe he's the Son of God. I believe that he died on Friday. I believe that he shed innocent blood. I believe that he went into a bar tomb. I believe that he was raised from the dead. I believe he sat on the right hand throne of the Father. I believe he's come back again. Yes, I believe all that, but nothing changed. Being saved means you've been rescued from the penalty of sin and the power of sin. I do not continue to live the same way I was living before I accepted Jesus Christ in my life. I'm no longer rude. I'm no longer a lover just of myself. I'm no longer a lover of material things. Let me just go ahead and drop this. Anybody know Young Thug? Know of him? Young Thug. I'm just going to say I know him. I thought I would get some parents who would actually support that. Unknow Young Thug. I want you to come to understand you all are not thugs. None of you are thugs. Anybody can tell me what a thug is, by the way? What's a thug?
A stealer.
Okay, he says a thug is a stealer. Anybody else can tell me what a thug is?
A person that is in a gang.
A person that may be in a gang.
Person that lives on the street.
Person that lives on the street, okay? That's their perception of a thug. What's a thug? What's the image of a thug? Huh? Somebody said low life. What's the image of a thug? What? There are all kinds of perceptions of what a thug is, but what are the rappers presenting a thug is? A player. Anybody know what a player is? A person who runs the women. Come on, somebody. We got to talk to these young people because they're picking up images and they're thinking it's all right. A thug is someone who really don't respect anybody. A thug is somebody who believes that they deserve whatever they deserve. However they get it, that's how they get it. They know the game. They know the street. Let me go ahead and say, anybody know what the record of the street is as it relates to victory and defeats? Anybody know what the record of the street is? Anybody been on the street before? And what I mean, anybody been raised up in the streets? Yeah, don't be ashamed. See, don't let this suit fool y'all. Do you mind me going? I see a head nodding. Do you mind if I come to you, my brother? Because he was nodding. Amen. I'm going to come over here. I'm almost finished, y'all. I'm trying to help these young people because, see, Young Thug is making some millions of dollars and he's making it off the expense of our children listening to him, or either he's bootlegging it, or either some industry has picked him up as a brand because they know that there are those who listen to Young Thug because they think that they are thug. And they were raised in the urban city. And mama wouldn't, even though they were raised in the urban city, mama wouldn't let them out in that street. Because you know what mama knew? The streets are undefeated. You are never going to defeat the streets. The streets will always defeat you. The streets, they are, no matter how much you think that you know the game, you don't know the game better than the street know it. Is there anybody in the house? I'm going to run over here for a minute. I'm sorry, producer. Tell him he's on.
Bottom line about the streets, there's no respect of person in the streets. It just go for what you know. There's no respect. When you're in the streets, you're going to get exactly what the streets got. Beat down, jails, hospitals, death, prison. That's what the street offers you. There is no love in the streets.
Young people, did y'all hear that? Don't let young thug fool y'all. Amen? Anybody know Chris Brown? I know it. Young people, come on, parents, y'all, y'all children, this is a young Chris Brown. You know, I see you. Amen. I see you. It's all right. I'm glad y'all being honest. Because, see, Chris Brown, let me just say something. I'm not trying to rain on Chris Brown and Young Thug's parade, but what they're doing, they are presenting something to our young people that they are basically, apparently, admiring. Chris Brown sees himself as a player. In other words, the women can't do without it. The young girls can't do without it. And what I want these young girls to understand that if you're looking for you a Chris Brown, you're looking for trouble. He can be good looking, smart, fine. He can sing like an angel. But if his lifestyle is not one that respects young women, young girls, if his lifestyle is not respecting himself and what he is doing and the message that he's putting out, then you don't want to have anything to do with what? Such people. Are y'all hear me? Lil Wayne? Young Jeezy, Soulja Boy, tell me, let me come down y'all street there. Tell me who they are here. Come on, give it up. Rich Kwame Kwan. Okay, Rich Kwame Kwan.
Rich on the Kwan.
Okay, Rich on the Kwan. All right, give me another one. All right. Migos. GK,
Snoop Dogg,
he go way back.
R. Kelly,
he go old school. Now y'all, you know, Jay-Z. I mean, he, you know, everybody won't be Jay-Z these days, you know. But Nicki Minaj, yeah, huh? But. She said, you said her name wrong, you know. Did I say Nikki? It's Nikki. Oh, I know the one that, you know, the one that got, what's it called? Anaconda. Y'all look at me like I'm crazy. Y'all, come on, y'all. Y'all ain't been so holier than thou. Y'all know y'all don't see Nicki Minaj. The thing is, I hope y'all ain't seen it. I'm just saying to our young people, there are things that you don't want to get caught up in. The reason I look at it, because I know y'all looking at it, so I got to preach on it. Nicki Minaj, I mean, you don't want your, how many want your daughters emulating Nicki Minaj? Y'all understand what I'm saying? comments, he shouldn't be saying that. Yes, we should. If anybody's going to say it, we need to be dealing with it while they're in the church. The one thing that I really have a really, really pet peeve about is that we come to the church and we want to be so holier than thou. We want to act as if we don't listen to nothing. We just listen to, God, me, oh, God, drink me, hope I'm a pilgrim in this barren land, I'm weak and I'm God. You know, y'all look, and it's good that y'all have grown to that. I'm not raining on that parade, but if I came up in here and start talking about sexual healing, Marvin Gaye, I mean, everybody's going to be, you know, Luther Vandross, you know, and you know, a little temptation. You know, it may not be yours today. It was one day. Is there anybody in this house? And I'm trying to let these young people know that you're right. The only thing the street is going to offer you is defeat. Don't get mesmerized by the street, because a lot of these hip-hoppers, these gangster hip-hoppers, they don't even own what they show on the video. Don't get mixed up. They're driving all the Benz. They're driving all these, they living in these real pockets. They don't own it. They rent it. A matter of fact, those companies are getting advertisement out of it. Only about 1 or 2% of them really, you know, a Puffy and a Jay-Z and a, you know, Beyonce and, you know, some of the others who have really done well. But the other ones, you know, they hand and fist. They may come out with 1 or 2, and then you don't hear about them no more. You understand what I'm saying? So don't ever get so mesmerized with these hip hoppers. And they are always promoting sex, drugs. They're degrading women, and then they're calling each other dogs. Referring to our girls as dogs. And you wonder why we have such an animalistic attitude towards one another? When I see you as an animal, it says to me, you really don't value much to me. And you know what it goes back to? You have to go back and read the history. In the Constitution itself, it says that we were like cattle. Our foreparents were like cattle. Not even equal to humans. And everything that your forefathers and foremothers died for to bring humanity to a level where we can be respected, we can have the access to various privileges and rights, and all of a sudden we now want to go back to being animalistic. That don't make sense. And our young people can't grow up thinking that they're less than animals. We have people who can take their dog to hospitals, and yet we have people who don't want to have health care for human beings. I'm just trying to help us, trying to help our young people. And then it says this, and we're going to get out of here. They will be proud, stuck up, rude, and disobedient to their parents. Let me just say this to you. The Bible is clear. It says, honor your mother and your father. Respect your mother and your father. Obey your mother and your father. Here's the promise. And your days will be longer on the earth. Don't ever let anybody cause you to disobey your mother or your father. It doesn't matter. It can be your BFF. Don't ever let your friend convince you to be disobedient to your mother and your father. If they do, if they are disobedient or rude to their mother and father, their father and mother, what does the Bible say about them? What are you to do? What did y'all cheer about? It says you don't want to have anything to do with such people. You have to be okay with establishing convictions and values as young Christians scholars,
Because, see, we're in a society where there are young people that have no convictions whatsoever. They'll just go whichever way the wind blows. We want you to be anchored in your conviction in terms of who you are as Christians, as followers of Christ. And Christ expects you to honor your mother and your father, to obey your mother and father. And he's promised it'll keep you out of some trouble. It'll keep you off the path of destruction. It'll keep you from ending up in jail. It'll keep you from being guilty by association, because there are a lot of young people who are innocent, but because they was in the wrong place at the wrong time, they're doing time. And mom and daddy can do nothing about it. And mom and daddy can tell you over and over, be careful who you hang out with. And I don't want it on my hand that I did not address this in a time where we have these kind of people that you're meeting and you're associating with day in and day out, and you're not here at the Fourth Street Missionary Baptist Church, and I have basically given you the word of God that says you need to not associate, you need to not have anything to do with such people. And if they have that kind of influence over you, mom and daddy, you need to say to your child, you need to cut loose. If a mother or a father, let me just go ahead and say this. If your child wants to go somewhere and they don't want you to talk with their best friend or their friend, mom and daddy, you need to say, that's something, mother, that's a red flag. If you want your child to do something or go somewhere, you need to talk with that parent first. We need to stop putting our children in situations to make adult decisions. This last one. You need to establish this protocol. If you ever want to do something, I need to know, one, who you're going to do it with. I need to know their names. I need to know where you're going. I need to know the date that you're going. I need to know the time that you're going. I need to know the place you're going. And I need the phone number to their parents. If I don't have that information, it's off. And here's the other thing. Don't come and ask me at the last minute. Are y'all following me? If you want to go something, it seems as though that y'all would have done some planning or talking about it. And the very moment the idea comes up, you need to start telling mom and daddy, I'm thinking about doing this. Okay, give me the name, give me the time, give me the place, give me the person you're going to be going out with, and tell me the parent's name, give me their number. When you give me that information, then we will let you know. Now, I know some parents say, well, that's a little bit too much, but you're guarding your children. And the children, now here's the thing, if your children get an attitude with that, you know something, you're doing something right. Are y'all, is this okay? Y'all might be angry with me. Are y'all angry with me today? Y'all, we okay, guys? We okay, ladies? We okay? Was this okay? This helpful? Now, you know what I want you to do? I want you to take 2 Timothy, chapter number 3, 1 through 9. I want you to ask God to give you the courage to sit down with someone this week and read it with them. Get the contemporary English version. Y'all got y'all iPhones with a Bible on. It's got different translations on there. Turn to the CEV version. And I want you to just say to some friends, let's read this. Let's see what God tells us to do about people who are rude, friends who are rude, or acquaintances. See, we keep putting tags on as friends, but they may not be your friend. Will y'all do that this week? Will y'all pray to God and just say, hey, I want to just share what we learned and from the message today. Will y'all do that? Now, let me just say this. If you do not have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, no matter what I've said today, it makes no difference. A matter of fact, it will sound like foolishness. A matter of fact, it will cause you to be so angry and so upset that you will think that not only myself, but your parents are trying to control who you're going to be spending time with. Your parents are trying to tell you who your friends are going to be and who your friends are not going to be. If you have that kind of attitude, then you need to come to Christ. Because here's what Christ wants you to do. He wants you to surrender your will first to Him. He wants you to surrender to His authority, to His rulership. And if you surrender earnestly and honestly to the rulership and the authority of God through Jesus Christ, then you will surrender to the authority of your parents. Whatever your parents command or instruct you to do, it won't be with an attitude. Because you now recognize that because of your relationship with God through Jesus Christ, He has placed them in your life. He has entrusted you to them to raise you as He desires you to be raised. And your parents will be a blessing to you. Your parents will be a tremendous, tremendous blessing to you. But you have to be willing to surrender. And so if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, this is what it means. It does not mean joining the church. Does not mean being baptized in water. It means earnestly believing that Jesus Christ died for you. He loved you that much that He gave His life to rescue you from the penalty of sin, which is spiritual death, from the power of sin, which means that if you are not rescued from the power of sin, then you will continue to live a sinful life. Even when you say, "I'm saved," you'll keep listening to Young Thug. You'll keep listening to Young Jeezy. You'll keep listening to Soulja Boy. You'll keep listening to Future. You'll keep listening to Chris Brown. You'll keep listening to 50 Cent. You'll keep listening to Nicki Minaj. You'll keep listening to what's her name, Sari? Y'all know, see, I knew y'all know. Literally. Some people say she's crazy. You'll keep listening to things that will end up destroying your mind, destroying relationships. So being saved means having a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, and you'll be willing to do exactly what He's instructed you to do. And He wants you to be an example for other young people just like you. He wants you to be an example of how not to be rude to your parents, how not to be rude to your teachers, how not to be rude to adults when you don't get your way. How not to just think about yourself and be self-centered, to be arrogant, to be aloof, to be standoffish, or to feel as though that you don't want to communicate with others. He will show you, you will not to be in cliques, but you can go in and out of situations and people will see you as real. You will not look down on people. You will show them. Because it's not you doing it. It's who's doing it through you. God, through Jesus Christ and His Holy Spirit, is doing it through you. You will not just love money or material things, but you can enjoy them. But if you learn that they're not the most important thing to you, that if you get them, God bless you, you thank God. If you don't, you're not going to have to go and do anything to try and get them in an illicit way. In a sneaky way, in a deceptive way. When you have a relationship with God, then you desire to please Him and not yourself. And you want to read and study His word because you come to realize He gets the glory. If you want a relationship with Him, I want you to come and I want you to stand right here. Now, if you've already said, "I believe in Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, Lord," I say, God bless you. Now, let's start learning how to live for Him. If you have not, if you know that you do not truly have a personal love, trust, obedient relationship with God through Jesus Christ, I want you to come and stand right here by me. If you know that you have not truly committed your life to Christ, maybe you say, "Well, Reverend Flakes, I know I've committed my life to Christ and I really love Him, but I'm not growing the way I should. I'm not attending church school. I don't come to Bible study." And parents, let me just say something. Bring your children to church school. Bring them to Bible study. Family Bible study is every Wednesday from 6 to 7. Midweek worship is 7 to 7:25. Bible studies from 7:25 to 8:15 and 8:30. Now here's the thing. If your child can stay in a football practice, basketball practice, go to dance for 2, 3, and 4 hours, surely they must be taught that God requires of them to study His Word. That's more important than anything else. The seeds must be planted that they will come to harvest, that they will learn. It will not happen by itself, no matter how much you tell them. If they do not have a relationship with Him, the Holy Spirit will not produce it in them. And so we want to invite you to come. Not only our young people, but if there's an adult, and you know you do not have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, maybe you are rude. Maybe you are a self-centered, money-loving person. Maybe you're the one that God has convicted today and said, you know what? I need God in my life that I can be an example to my children. I can be an example to my grandchildren. Don't allow the pride to keep you from allowing God to change you. So unashamed, unembarrassed, we want you to stand to your feet. And we want you to come. First of all, to receive Jesus Christ as your first own personal Savior Lord. If you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior Lord, we want you to come this today. If you know that you have not been dedicated